You might remember this track cleaning car that I built a while back. I've been meaning to do something about it to make it look a little bit less like something that I've hacked together and more like a real freight car that's doing some work. And for that, of course, you need a load. Now, I've seen lots of people model pipe loads and scrap loads and spare wheel loads. Another common thing that you'd see in the real world, especially back in days gone by, is pulpwood loads were popular. Gravel or ballast or coal. None of those really fit the theme of my railroad, though. And as for the rest of the stuff, well, I've got a scrap load, I've got a wheel load, I've got another scrap load, I've got a pipe load, I've got another scrap load. Got some machinery back there. But what I don't have is some huge crated mysterious equipment, which is also something that you find in some prototype photos. So that is what I'm going to do with this guy. The first thing you're going to need if you're going to build wooden crates is, of course, wood. Over the years, I've accumulated fair variety of it, different sources, some of it like this northeastern scribed siding down here, came from hobby shops, but also various dowels from craft stores. There's some strip wood from hobby shop, but I've also got some wooden coffee stir sticks from dollar stores and a bunch of match sticks and some wooden tongue depressors. Some bamboo skewers and various other things. Oh, and these, which in this size are pretty much 4x8 sheet of plywood, but in this size are a business card made out of wood veneer. I bought a package of like 50 of them or something from Lee Valley Tools for only a few dollars a whole bunch of years ago. And doesn't that look like the basis for a wooden crate? I think so. The other thing that you need on a wooden crate is supporting strips, which I'm not sure if these pieces of coffee stirrer are going to be a reasonable size. I think matchsticks might be a little bit thick. We'll get them over to the HO scale ruler and measure them. But the other thing that I've got is this supply of strip wood over here. This I got again years ago. Some of it, the stuff with barcodes on it, came from the hobby shops, just as usual. But these back here are all from a huge bundle that I got from a guy at a show that was selling wood, but not a model railroad show. That all came from a guy who was selling wood at a dollhouse show, of all things. You never know where you're gonna find your modeling supplies. Keep your eyes open. Anyway, I'm gonna drag some of this stuff over to the workbench and we'll see what we can do with it. So I guess the first thing we need to do, let's figure out how big to make this this unit. The minimum size. Well, okay. Then can you see that one, or can you see this one better? That might be easier. So I think the minimum size we want is 12 feet. What does 16 feet long look like? Yeah, I think 16 feet would stay between those ribs. It would explain why it's so massive. Yeah, okay. So, we'll go 16 feet that way. The width is going to be close to the width of the car, which, well, let's just make it 8 feet because that's nice and easy. Now, in the real world, I would do stuff in metric, but down here in miniature world, everything is in feet and inches, because that's just how you can't find, or at least not here in North America, anyway, you can't find a metric HO scale ruler. It's all in old measurements. So, for height, damn reflections, 6 feet. Yeah, that'll stick up out of the car. How deep is the car? The car is 3 feet. So yeah, I think we'll make it 6 feet in a 6 foot tall crate, which is this dimension here. Okay. So now, we'll start just by cutting out the plywood. And as I showed you before, I'm going to use these veneer business cards. And nothing looks more like wood than wood. Okay, I suppose, since you're not going to see the thickness of it, I suppose I could use these tongue depressors too. How big are they? They are about 5 3/4 feet. Now, I think I'll stick to these, but I'll pick some that don't have all this fancy spalted grain. Some that have a more normal green like those. Because I want it to look like I'm using plywood, not fancy wood. And for the structure of it internally, I'm going to be super cheap and use matchsticks. Well, actually, no, they're not matchsticks. They're, some of them might be matchsticks. The smaller ones are. But I'll use that for the internal structure. And then for the outside, to make it look like it's actually built from the outside, I'm going to use some of that, which I think, we'll zoom back in here. Where's the center of my zoom? That's going to be 6 scale inches that way and 2 or 3 that way. So our crate's going to be braced on the outside with scale 2x6s. So now then, just like doing carpentry in the real world, I think I'll cut my top first. Just like doing carpentry in the real world, just measure it, mark it, and cut it. Slightly different tools, but not too much different. So what did I want? 16 feet long? Now, for once, I'll actually use my X-Acto knives for the purpose for which they were purchased, and not just for opening mailbags. And the cutting mat, too, actually. When was the last time I used the cutting mat to actually cut on? There, just a bunch of light strokes and we're through. So that's our 16 feet that way. Now I want to come 8 feet this way. Oops, that's the O scale side. Let's not use that. And let's use this one because it's just a little bit easier to see what's going on. That other one's creating an awful lot of glare off the lights. So 8 feet there. Keep it in frame. 8 feet there, and just the same thing again. The reason I'm using the metal ruler to cut with is because I don't, if I happen to get off my line, I won't gouge it, but I will gouge the plastic one all to hell. Okay. So there is my 8x16 top piece. It's going to go there. Now that I need a couple of 6x8 pieces. Okay, there's all the pieces of the crates, all the side pieces of the crate. I'm actually going to have to fill that piece in up there once it's built. But I'll use some of these offcuts for that, because I have several of those still. So now, I'm going to start gluing it all together. Ah, don't mix that up. So we'll build it upside down. And as I said before, we'll use these pieces for bracing lumber on the inside. Which means we want this. So we'll use these pieces for bracing lumber. But they don't have to be quite as exact in length. They can just get cut to whatever length they need to be cut and fit. So that is gonna sit like that and brace that piece. Have to glue these. I'll use my machinist squares to hold them up. And to hold them from falling over, I'll just put a magnet on there. That just goes in there and goes like that. Weight this piece down. And I need some glue. Okay, back with a bit of wood glue. Actually, just general all-purpose white glue, not even using special purpose wood glue. Okay, squirt out a bit of wood glue onto a convenient tray. Using a toothpick or, you know, whatever. Spread some out on there. Not too particular, not too precise. Some down there. I mean, this isn't massively structural. Not going to be hanging stuff off it. It's a decorative crate. And then something suitable to just sewing magnet. Something suitable to just squish that into there. another little gob on there. And let that dry for a while. Now I'm going to actually move this weight around and into the middle, and I'm going to repeat the process on this end with another weight or machinist square and another end piece and another little magnet. And another shtick cut precisely to the approximate length that I need. Okay, now wait for glue to dry. You want to watch that? Didn't think so. Okay, time has passed. Glue is dried. Take this all apart here. Oh, good, nothing's there. Okay. There's a crate, and it will more or less sit down over there. I got a bit of trimming to do, but that's a good start now. Doing those two panels. With a couple of these offcuts. Actually, first. Oh, no. Okay, so. My pieces don't have to go any further down than that, because that's where they'll be seen. And actually, I see what's going on here. So these sheets are a little bit sloped and these aren't. So I just got to take a little bit of an angle off the bottom of them. I don't know if you can see in there. No, you can't. And I just to make them sit down properly. Zoom back out again. I'll just, where's my mark there? I'm just kind of eyeball this and knock a piece off the corners. There. Come in. This is, as usual, a cut to fit project. This isn't super measured, it's not super precise, not rocket surgery. Okay, that's not going to be visible. I'll just repeat that three times. Okay. There. That sits down in there well. Okay. So now I'll just brace across the inside with a couple of sticks and glue them on. And cut my piece to fit. And stick that on. Oh yeah. One thing. One reason why I use these little Dixie cups for my gluing is the glue, when it's dry, just pops right off. Throw the toothpick away. I know it's horribly wasteful, but sometimes you gotta splurge. Get a fresh toothpick, fresh blob of glue. And carry on. There's that one glued in. Now then, yes, it's ugly, but when I put my boards over top, that will hide a multitude of sins. Any gaps are going to get hidden by that. So now then, for that to glue, flip it over like that. Park a bit of weight on it. Where's the other one? There it is, a smaller one. Park some weight on there and leave it for the night. Okay, the glue is dried on this guy now. However, I made that side a little bit high. But it occurred to me that these little dividing pieces in here don't need to be nearly that tall. If I'd realized that a lot earlier, it would have saved me a lot of effort on making this thing. But so it goes. That's just how my shop works. So I shall just shave these pieces down a little bit here. Towards myself just because it's more dangerous. Just chop those down to a reasonable size and carry on. And there we go. Sits down there fairly well. Those gaps down there are going to be filled like any of the other gaps with my 2x6. So that's the next step, is to trim out my crate. Oh, yeah, that all fits. So I think what I'm going to do is on that side and that side, basically reinforce every edge of every side of the crate, because I've seen actual crates in the real world like that. And like everything else on this, it's just going to be cut to fit. So just get back. Actually, hang on, I'm going to adjust the camera here. Okay, after adjusting the camera rather traumatically, so I'll just measure it exactly off the size of the box. Snip. There's one for a top edge, and I'm just going to keep going. We'll be right back. Okay, now that the glue's dried, I've discovered that I made a bit of a mistake here. I cut the box to fit exactly, and then I put the bracing on it. So, I have to trim it down a bit. And I'll do that with this chisel blade in my X-Acto, and I will try not to completely destroy everything. I'm not going to go right down to the plywood because I'm hoping that just by narrowing it some, I can get it to fit in there. I'm just going to do a bit of carving here. And then it'll still visually have that on there. That's my hope anyway. So that it won't look completely retarded. There we go. One crate full of mysterious open cargo. Well, no, mysterious cargo, but an open load in my car. So now, instead of looking like that, it looks like it's actually doing something. I'm gonna